Hello and welcome to the Fourth Down and Goal podcast, and we are going for it. This episode is brought to you by Boats and Hose, Tuolumne County, California's premier one-stop shop for a day at the lake or a day in your lavender garden. That is a made-up place. It does not exist yet, but it is a million-dollar idea. Come on, you're going to tell me that you wouldn't shop at a marina slash garden store? Stop lying to me and, more importantly, yourself. But this introduction is somewhat elusive, alludatory. It alludes to the topic of today's episode. Thank you guys so much for joining me. My name is Jeff Bowden. I am going to be your host for this episode and for every episode because I run this show. Welcome in again. Thank you for joining me for the next episode of our United Football League roster breakdowns. I'm going to be getting into each one of these teams and diving deep and finding out as much as we can about the roster to try and make some kind of assessment going into week one and, just getting a better understanding of what these teams are bringing to the table with their talent and maybe a little bit of what we might see from them as the season progresses as far as X's and O's and scheme. So today's episode is going to be on the Memphis Showboats. Before we get too far into the episode, I would just ask everybody for a quick like if you are watching on YouTube, if you are listening to this podcast on Apple Podcast or Spotify, a quick 5-star review goes a very long way in helping out this show grow and make its way up the rankings. So helps out a lot. Quick like on YouTube, quick 5 stars. Doesn't matter what you say in your review. You can tell me that you disagree with everything I'm about to say before I even say it. It's just those 5 stars that count. So that would be greatly appreciated. And then another quick disclaimer. This episode currently right now is being recorded on March 8th, and we're expected to see some roster movement pretty quickly here. I'll do my best to try and get updated rosters get roster movement as it progresses, cut in and out of these episodes. But I can't promise that I'm going to be perfect on it. I might end up releasing these episodes well before certain roster moves are made. We'll do our best. There is a likelihood that some of these episodes get released, and some of the guys that I mention on here may not be on the team. But in reverse, if I am missing players or I'm skimming over guys that I just don't know about, and you guys are, definitely reach out to me on my social medias and, let me know. Like, this guy's a dog. You're not paying attention to this dude. Look his way. So real quickly for that, my social medias are at Fourth Down and Goal Pod on Instagram, and then on Twitter it is @fourthdowngoalpod. They have some kind of prejudice against conjunctions, so my username on Twitter makes no sense. But yeah, if you guys are listening to these episodes, and again, like I'm missing information, definitely reach out. Any kind of help is appreciated. So without further ado, let's get into the Memphis Showboats. This is one of the teams that I'm most excited about diving into. I think a lot of what they did over the offseason doesn't get talked about the amount that I feel like it should. I mean, they basically combined the New Orleans Breakers and the Memphis Showboats of last year into this awesome mega team. I think Memphis had a lot of the foundational pieces already in place from last year, but then you bring in head coach John DeFilippo, who took a bunch of his New Orleans guys with him. You nail the quarterback find with Case Cookus. You bring in Darius Victor for the run game, and some really significant guys from really prominent who played really prominent roles on some really successful teams last season, such as Christian McFarlane, a safety coming over from Birmingham to complement that secondary. I think this roster is kind of a dark horse, and I hope that more people become aware of it as we talk about this team in this episode. So I tried I try in all my episodes to gather stats from the team's previous season to give a little bit of context for what we might be looking at as far as improvement or decline going into this season. For the Memphis Showboats for 2024, what I did was I took New Orleans 2023 team stats of the New Orleans Breakers and use those because it's basically the same coaching staff and a majority of the roster comes over to Memphis. So last year under John DeFilippo, the New Orleans Breakers were 7-3 in a very scrappy USFL South Division. They made a playoff appearance, but we don't talk about that game. The only way to go for John DeFilippo, though, is up. He has the roster to make it happen all over again. And I think at minimum, make a playoff appearance. So let's get into the roster itself. Undoubtedly, starting with the quarterback room, the most stable quarterback room in the United Football League, in my opinion. You got Case Cookus, who I think is probably going to be the starter, most likely, I would say. One of the most fun spring football quarterbacks who stepped in for a mid at best Philadelphia Stars midway through 2022 and nearly won that team a championship game. Last year, he was a top two quarterback, but for a second year in a row, just had an awful defense and a putrid O-line, which by the season's end caused them to miss the playoffs. And I believe Case Cookus was the most sacked quarterback in the USFL last season. Luckily this year, I think he's going to have way more time to throw. I believe the majority of the offensive line is from the original Memphis squad. And that was a very, very good offensive line. But he's going to have more time to throw this year. And I think a coach in John DeFilippo who can scheme things open and make the game itself slow down a bit more for Cookus. And this is said with the knowledge that if you ask Case Cookus to boat race another high power offense and put up 35 points, he can. But I think the defense for Memphis will likely make it so he doesn't have to do so week in, week out. I think Case Cookus is going to flourish with John DeFilippo, who can scheme things open and make things easy from a play-calling standpoint, and then it's going to be awesome to finally see him behind an offensive line that's not going to leave him running for his life. So, next on the quarterback list, you got Troy Williams, who was the best option you could possibly have. I would say it's not impossible that he could start at some point. I don't really think he will. I would lean towards Cookus, but Troy Williams is the best option you could have for what you might call either a high-end backup to actually a very, very good starter. He was the quarterback for the USFL championship runner-up Pittsburgh Maulers in 2023. He had a very strong end to the season, but proved throughout to be a quarterback who is not going to turn the ball over. And in the same breath, he will take a big play when he finds them. He's also very mobile. And say he starts at some point, you could see a whole new offensive scheme for Memphis. I wouldn't totally rule him out as a starter for Memphis. I do think he is going to make Case Cookus work for it. But if nothing else, if he ends up sitting behind Case Cookus, he is also a fine potential trade option if another team needs to make it a change at quarterback midseason. And at QB3, they cut Cole Kelly, who was okay for them last year, and they bring in Josh Love, who started for the Michigan Panthers for the majority of the year. And Love is probably one of the highest-end backups available in the United Football League. I think he has a lot of tools to be a very good quarterback, but he just needs coaching and guidance. But I think this is a very favorable situation for him. You have a very, very solid quarterback room. I have no concerns whatsoever with their quarterback room unless somehow everybody ends up on the injured reserve. Let's get into these running backs, though, starting with Darius Victor, one of the best running backs in both USFL seasons. He is this league's Austin Eckler, but it's like if Austin Eckler ate Austin Eckler. That's Darius Victor. Huge pickup for Memphis. Should give them a great run game behind a very good offensive line. You also have Trey Williams, who, if I remember correctly, had two really good seasons with the New Jersey Generals and also had a really good season before COVID killed the 2020 XFL season. So, you know, you got two really, really good running... Well, put it this way. You have one really, really good running back and then another pretty good running back behind him with Darius Victor and Trey Williams. I do have some questions about depth, but I would imagine as the season goes on and movement throughout the roster continues to fluctuate, they'll probably bring in a third option. But I feel pretty good about the options that they have currently. Let's jump into these receivers now. We'll start with the tight end group, and I just want to start off. I am so excited to watch Case Cookus with an actual tight end at his disposal. Every quarterback needs his go-to tight end. I can't think of any quarterback to wide receiver combination that is quite like some of the quarterback to tight end combinations we've seen over the years. You know, Rivers to Gates, Brady to Gronk, freaking Mahomes to Kelsey, you name it. Like, every quintessential piece of an offense that I feel kind of gets overlooked nowadays in today's, you know, NFL and maybe spring football a little bit, but that quarterback to tight end combo just is the piece de resistance to an offense, and I can't wait to see this happen for the Memphis Showboats, because with Sage Surratt, whatever, I've thought of a way to try and articulate this, whatever George Kittle / Travis Kelce type of debate we make for the USFL, or I'm sorry, the UFL, I feel like Surratt needs to be in that conversation when it comes to the Jay Sternbergers and Sal Canellas of the spring football world. He's phenomenal. He was a star last year with the Breakers, and so I'm excited. It'll be awesome to see Coach Flip bring his star tight end over and implement him into an offense where, you know, last year with McLeod Bethel Thompson, he shined. He was a star. So it'll be really exciting to see what ends up happening with, you know, a clear improvement at quarterback, and that's definitely no slight to McLeod Bethel Thompson. For the wide receivers, I don't know if this is necessarily the most underappreciated wide receiver room in the United Football League, but I would say it's probably one of them. Trust me when I say you have to have a lot of good wide receivers in your unit to cut Derek Dillon, who I think and hope will find a home with a team somewhere in the U.S. or in the United Football League. Because to see him get cut from Memphis after such a stellar season last year, you know, it really speaks volumes to the talent that John DeFilippo brought over from New Orleans and also picked up during free agency. You know, you got guys like John Adams coming over from the Breakers. He has amazing hands, 6'3", has speed. You got guys like Vinny Papale coming over from the, or originally, he was coming over from the USFL Bandits of 2022. Came over to Memphis last year and had himself an all USFL season. And then a couple really, really good depth pieces like Lee Morris coming over from the Breakers, DeAndre Overton, a good pickup from the Stars. He'll have some familiarity with Case Cookus, and Dee Anderson as well, joining Don DeFilippo and joining the Memphis coming over from the Breakers. I think this receiving room is awesome, dude. I cannot wait to see who ends up being the number one. I would probably say it comes down to either John Adams or Vinny Papale, but either one of those guys would complement the other in a one or two spot. You can do a lot of things with Vinny Papale. You can put him outside, you can put him in the slot, and then of course John Adams is your big contested catch deep route type of route runner. And then, of course, you know, Dee Anderson and Lee Morris, like we said, make really good 3 and 4 pieces. And I'll be interested to see how some of these guys, maybe DeAndre Overton, can work his way into the depth chart. Or, you know, at worst, I think all three of those guys I just mentioned are going to be really, really effective rotational pieces. I think you have a lot that you can do with this receiving core. Overall, though, I love this offense. I love this offense, dude. I really hope it looks similar to what we saw with the New Orleans Breakers in 2023. And if you don't know, that was a high-flying, chunk plays on the ground and through the air type of offense. I mean, they had it dialed in for most of the year. And this year, with a quarterback room that you can do just about anything with, if you have to have guys come off the sideline, a running game that should be a force of its own and a complement for the passing game. And you have a receiving core that has, you know, a lot of diversity in player strength. A few different guys I could see, again, end up being the number one, or being, well, just a receiver room with three guys who are one of three. And on top of that, some really solid depth pieces to boot. So these guys are going to be a ton of fun to watch. Let's get into this defense now, starting with the defensive line. You got guys like John Atkins coming back for his second year in Memphis. He was all USFL last year, 6'3" and 320 pounds. He is a beast. You got guys like Jeff McCulloch coming back for his third year in spring football. He's a solid player. I'll be interested to see where exactly he lands on the depth chart, actually. I feel like he's got a good shot at playing beside... I believe if I remember correctly, he's an edge rusher. He probably will start, and they'll have him lined up on the outside. Number 33, though. Watch out for him. He's fun. You got some really, really good depth pieces, actually, in guys like Tyshawn Render, third-year man pickup from the New Jersey Generals. You got Connor Christensen, two good seasons from... the Breakers, probably coming over with John DeFilippo. So, you know, with those guys, you also have a bunch of guys on the depth list who are, you know, one of the main reasons I feel very optimistic about this defensive line is that most of the guys there are sitting around 6'3", 285 and up, along with some all USFL talent and NFL experience. You know, I think it'll give him the upper hand. I feel very good about this defensive line. Now for the linebackers, you got Vontae Diggs, who to me was the most underappreciated linebacker in the USFL in 2023. 69 tackles, 3 interceptions, 2.5 sacks last year. The guy was just everywhere for the Breakers last year. Super fun player to watch. And then you got Anthony Butler, a third-year player, has two very solid seasons under his belt so far. And then Max Roberts had a good year with the Vegas Vipers last year and was also a member of the 2021 Los Angeles Rams team that ended up winning the Super Bowl. So I feel like maybe he can step up in the steps chart if nothing else brings experience. And I believe Greg Reeves at this point in time is still on the roster. He's coming in for his third year of spring football. Another good piece to have. So I don't think this is necessarily the most feared linebacker group, but I think they have strength in having guys with experience, some at the NFL level, and most of them with very solid seasons behind them. Talking about the secondary now, there's a good amount of guys on here who I am really, really stoked to watch. You know, you got the safety Christian McFarland coming over from the 2023 USFL Championship Birmingham defense, and he was awesome last year. You got DJ Daniel, who was all USFL team in 2023. And if you knew nobody on the New Jersey Generals, you knew DJ Daniel. This dude is locked down. You also have Jerry Elder, the safety acquired from New Orleans. Had a great 2023. He'll be a force. You have Dalerick Abrams Jr., his third year in the USFL. But another excellent acquisition for this Memphis Showboats secondary. which I think is awesome. You have all USFL guys, you have guys coming over from the championship Birmingham defense, and guys coming over from what was a very, very good Breaker secondary. I would keep an eye on this unit. I feel like they're going to be one of the better secondaries in the UFL. So I want to be one of the first to give this defense its flowers in case we get to like week five and nobody's talking about them and they're performing to the level I believe that they're capable of. I just want to plant my flag in the ground now, and I'm going to say that this defense is going to be very good. And if I'm wrong, I'll eat those words, but I truly believe this unit goes far more under the radar than is respectful. So projected win total that I have for the Memphis Showboats, I almost just called them the New Orleans Breakers, 6.5 wins. I think that's a fair over and under for the Showboats. They have the roster talent to make just about every game on their schedule a game worth watching, and would not be surprised in the least if they came in underdogs in some of these games and use that motivation to their advantage and ultimately come out on top in some of these matchups. They have a fiery coach who gets his guys to buy into him and also knows what he's doing from an X's and O's standpoint. And they smashed it in free agency on both sides of the ball. I am so excited to finally see what Case Cookus can do behind a good offensive line with a good running game and a strong group of receivers. Not to mention a defense that will likely keep the offense from needing to put up 30 points every single week. Keep in mind, Case Cookus, how do I phrase this? Case Cookus took a bad Philadelphia Stars team to a championship in 2022. And they were bad last year, and he still was a top two quarterback in the USFL. So for more context, Case Cookus has never had a good offensive line, and he's never had a good defense. Both of the years, his offensive line was bottom two. Again, I believe he was the most sacked quarterback in the USFL last year. And I believe both seasons of the USFL, the Philadelphia Stars defense was like seventh or dead last completely. So I'm stoked to watch this team. I rank these guys as number three in my power rankings, and I'm going to stand by that. Even if they have a slow start, I think that this is a team that nobody is going to want to play if they start ripping off wins. With that, that is going to wrap it up for this episode. Thank you guys for joining me on my roster breakdown of the Memphis Showboats. Hope you enjoyed. If I missed anybody, again, DM me on social media or tweet me. You know, if I missed a player that you know of and I don't, and you're like, yo, this guy's a stud, definitely reach out. I will look into them. And if I am able to and I haven't released this episode, I'll try and do my research and cut that guy into his appropriate segment. So to follow on my social media, I am on Instagram and I am on Twitter. My Instagram is at fourthdownandgoalpod, and my Twitter is at fourthdowngoalpod, which just sounds so mind-numbingly stupid. I wish Twitter had more characters for usernames so that my handle could actually make sense over there. But yeah, if you could do that and give me a quick follow, also, of course, that's appreciated. Also, if you could do a huge favor one more time, if you're watching on YouTube, just give this video a quick like. And if you'd be so kind to hit the subscribe button and turn on the notification bell. Or if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, just a quick 5-star review. Again, doesn't matter what you say in the review. You can tell me that, I don't know, that you want to kick my dog and insult my mother. Don't kick my dog and don't insult my mother. I'll put hands on you, boy. But yeah, again, those 5 stars are really only what count, and it is super appreciated. Thank you guys once again for joining me. Keep on reaching for the pylons, friends, and we'll see you next time. Peace!